सूर्यकोटिसमप्रभा निर्विघ्नं कुरु मे देव सर्वकार्येषु सर्वदा या कुन्देन्दुतुसारहारधवला या शुभ्रवस्त्रावृता या वीणामृदण्डमण्डितकरा या श्वेतपद्मासना या ब्रह्माच्युतशङ्करप्रभृतिभिर्देवैः सदा वन्दिता सा मां पातु सरस्वती भगवती निःशेषजड्यापहा नम शिवानन्दाय गुरवे सच्चिदानन्दमूर्तये निष्प्रपञ्चाय शान्ताय निरालम्बाय तेजसे न गुरोरधिकं तत्त्वं न गुरोरधिकं तपः न गुरोरधिकं ज्ञानं तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः नित्यशुद्धं निराभासं निराकारं निरञ्जनं नित्यबोधं चिदानन्दं गुरुं ब्रह्म नमाम्यहम् अज्ञानतिमिरान्धस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः ध्यानमूलं गुरोर्मूर्तिः पूजामूलं गुरोः पदं मन्त्रमूलं गुरोर्वाक्यं मोक्षमूलं गुरोः कृपा लोकाभिरामं रणरङ्गधीरं राजीवनेत्रं रघुवंशनाथं कारुण्यरूपं करुणाकरन्तं श्रीरामचन्द्रं शरणं प्रपद्ये ओंकारं विन्दुसंयुक्तं नित्यं ध्यायन्ति योगिनः कामदं मोक्षदं चैव ओंकाराय नमो नमः वसुदेवसुतं देवं कंसचाणूरमर्दनं देवकी परमानन्दं कृष्णं वन्दे जगद्गुरुं दिविभूमौ तथाकाशे बहिरन्तश्च मे विभुः यो विभाति भासात्मा तस्मै सर्वात्मने नमः ॐ श्री परमात्मने नमः Revered Atman, revered Self, all the spiritual seekers, seekers of yoga, it's a very nice occasion for us to meet here, and I am also very lucky to come to this place, this blue mountain, Katoomba, and this yoga center here, Sivananda Yoga Center, and following the guidelines of most revered Sri Swami Vishnu Devananji Maharaj, who has been the source of inspiration for this center, and we have also, of course, he derived his inspiration from Swami Chidananda Maharaj, who is our holy master for all of us, and he is our original source. So it is very good that we have got this occasion to meet here, and I am very happy to see you all here. You are all very sincere, keen yoga aspirants, and walking the path of yoga, practicing yoga and also teaching yoga, spreading the message of yoga to all. That's also a very excellent thing, and I am very happy to see you all. Now here, of course, we have the occasion for us to come here. Of course, you are all here, but I had come here because of that centenary celebrations. Our Divine Life Society Australia, very enthusiastically they have been celebrating and very fittingly also, the birth centenary of most worshipful Swami Chidananda Maharaj. And in that context, we are also having this some programs at different places. And in Sydney also, you are going to have this the drama, which is going to be staged on this 23rd April. This is Chidananda, an ocean of compassion. So that has all, you see, brought us together here. That is the occasion for which we have come. Now here in this, Swami Sivananda Maharaj, he had set up the Divine Life Society. You all know about it. And his mission was to awaken people. Because we are all in the deep slumber of ignorance, all of us, the entire world. We are all groping under darkness, darkness of ignorance. That is why we are also suffering in this life. Where there is ignorance, we will not be able to know what we should do, what we should not do, what is good for us and what is not. And that is why most often we commit mistakes, and then as a result of that we suffer in this life. So ignorance is the cause of all suffering for all of us. Not only in the spiritual path, but in the world itself. If you are not fully convergent with things, we will do something wrong and then come to grief. That is what happens. So ignorance is the cause of our suffering. And Swami Sivananda Maharaj, Gurudev, Swami Sivananda Maharaj, his main idea of setting up this Divine Life Society was to awaken the people, rouse the people from this sleep of ignorance and to take us to light. That was his mission. That is how he set up the Divine Life Society. And he himself was a realized saint. He realized, had got realization. And he also, the inspiration for him also to take to serious spiritual practices, that was also, he found that people are actually suffering a lot in the world. Even if I do so much, for as a doctor in Malaya at the time, he did so much of service to the people, yet people were not happy. He couldn't make them happy for all time to come. That is why he found that this is not the solution for all our problems. If somebody falls ill physically, we will give him some treatment, he may be all right for a few days, but thereafter again lapse back into the same problem and have the suffering. And people are unhappy, facing sorrow, suffering, like that. Then he said, what is the way, what I can do to give the people something by which they can be happy for all time to come. And then he says that before I want to give to others, I must first know myself. What is the way to have this lasting happiness? What will give us, you see, freedom from all sorrow for all time to come? And that was his quest, and that was the urge with which actually in his last days in Malaya. And then he gave up this. He said that he had read some books of scriptures and all these other great saints and sages. He said, the only thing is to, if we have God realization, if we attain liberation, then only we can have the way to get permanent happiness. Because when we have liberation or moksha as it is called in Sanskrit, this moksha is the definition or what exactly means. We know moksha means liberation. You are free, you have freedom. But freedom from what? What type of freedom is that? For the liberation, you see, or moksha, there is a definition. They say that it will be sarva-dukkha nivritti. Sarva-dukkha nivritti means cessation of all sorrow. That is it. So when we have liberation, that is the first gain. That is the first, you see, this benefit that we have from this. Our sorrows will come to an end for all time to come. Sarva dukkha nivritti, all sorrows. And then he says that it is as paramananda prapti. We attain when we have this second benefit that we can get is Paramananda Prapti. That means attainment of supreme bliss. Normally we are all keen to have happiness. All of us, we want only happiness in life. That is the only quest for every human being, and even for all other creatures also, we want to be comfortable and happy in life. That is the basic quest. And so, we are aware or we are familiar with this ordinary type of happiness. I want something, if I get it, I become happy. It's a question of a little satisfaction. This type of happiness only we are acquainted with. But this happiness, when we get liberation, that it says that, you see, the liberation means, you see, supreme bliss. It is not even happiness, beyond happiness. Happiness is normally is considered or taken to be a state of our mind, a mental state. But this bliss they are talking of, that is much beyond even the mind also. So that is supreme bliss, more intensive happiness than this ordinary happiness. That is bliss. So that we will get. Not only we will get happiness, but we will get supreme bliss. That's why they call it Paramananda Prapti, attainment of supreme bliss. That means we will be happy for all time to come, eternal happiness. And there is a third gain also from this. They say that, you see, Nitya Trupti. That means we have satisfaction eternally, eternal satisfaction. All of us want satisfaction. We don't want to have any need, anything, any requirement, anything else. If we don't have any need or any requirement, then we are satisfied. So this satisfaction also we want to have that. So when we have that particular liberation, that state, in that state, you see, there won't be any further craving. There will not be further need or any hankering. Nothing will be there. There will be eternal satisfaction. So this eternal satisfaction also will come. This is liberation or moksha. This liberation is, so by this we will get sarva dukkha nivruti. We also want that we will not have any sorrow or suffering in life. Nobody wants suffering. So since that is our basic requirement and we are keen about it, that we will get. We will get supreme bliss and we will also have eternal satisfaction. So whatever we can think of, things that we may be needing in life or whatever we may be wanting, all those things are attained, you see, by when we have this liberation. So there will be no further problem, no worry, and a person will be left. And that is a state by realizing which or attaining which one can be, even he will not be disturbed by the worst of, you see, this sorrow or suffering. Yasmin sito na dukhe na gurunapi vichalyate. Like that in the Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna says. Being established in that particular state of liberation, a person is not disturbed or shaken or agitated even by the worst or the most intense suffering or pain that we can think of. That also will not disturb that type of state. This is liberation. So, Gurudev Swami Sivananda Maharaj thought, let me have that particular state. Let me acquire the skill for that and also reach that state. And after having gone to that state, that knowledge also I will try to share with others. So that will be the best service that I can render to other people. Not this ordinary medical treatment, physical service that I am giving. That is why I should do that. So that, then he said that if for that I must do myself spiritual practices. I will plunge into practice and then attain that liberation or the final state, and then I will share all my knowledge, all the good things or all the skills that I attain. I will try to give it to others. That was with that idea actually he came over to India from Malaya, gave up that lucrative and rolling medical practice and came back to India and did the spiritual practices, and he also got liberation. He became a Jivan Mukta, or one who is liberated while living. He attained the state of liberation even while still he was alive. That is called a person, when he reached that stage, he can continue to live as before, yet he will be in a state of liberation. That is called liberation while living. A jivan mukta, a one who is liberated even when he is alive. That state he is able. So, Gurudev Swami Sivananda, having attained that, then he said that, you see, I must try to give it to others. I should not be thinking about myself only. I must share this knowledge with others. That is why he started giving talks and discourses and advice to other people, those who came to him. Thereafter, he also went around to different places within India to give some discourses, organize some conferences, or to give some spiritual instructions. And thereafter, they thought, Swamiji thought, some people told him that, Swamiji, how much service you can do as a single individual? You can't do so much because the output will be very limited, and you may not be able to reach all the people, although that is your basic urge and keenness to attain that. Then he said that, okay, then it is better, why not you start an organization? If you start an organization, through the medium of the organization, you will be able to reach to so many people, and you can share with this knowledge even more rapidly and wider and more effectively also. And Gurudev caught up this idea, of very good. When he heard that, on the same day, he had gone to Lahore for attending some Sankirtan conference was there. So he was returning from there, and at Ambala immediately he got down. He said, oh, this idea, no, if it's a good idea, do it now. Din, as Gurudev always says, D-I-N, do it now. Since it's a good idea, why to delay it? He had no plan to get down there, so he broke his journey there, got down at Ambala, and then he registered that Divine Life Society on the same day. Within a few hours, you see, he caught hold of some lawyer, and then he drafted, and then there it was registered on the same day. That was his spirit with which Gurudev Swami Sivananda was working, and very keen about doing something good to others. For that he would not postpone. So like that, Gurudev Swami Sivananda, the Divine Life Society was born. So the mission of Gurudev Swami Sivananda Maharaj, as it is expressed through the Divine Life Society. Divine Life Society is the medium through which his ideas are actually spread. Whatever he wanted to do, that he chose to do it through the Divine Life Society. And that is Gurudev's mission, Swami Sivananda Maharaj's mission. And the mission is the first most important objective of that mission is, just as it was started only with that idea, it is only for spreading spiritual knowledge, dissemination of spiritual knowledge. That is our Gurudev's, that is the first objective, first and primary objective. And in fact, that is the only thing for which the Divine Life Society was started. All other things are only incidental and supplementary. So Gurudev's mission was only to spread spiritual message, spiritual knowledge throughout the world. He was keen to see that every individual on this earth plane, on the earth, she should have that knowledge. Because as he felt, and he tells us also, that by having the spiritual knowledge also only, all our this ignorance will go, and then we will know, we have the clue to how to reach that particular state with Gurudev Swami Sivananda Maharaj had reached, how to attain liberation and how to have permanent happiness, how to also, you see, this free from all sorrow and suffering, misery, and how we can be eternally satisfied, all these things with that. So Gurudev's mission was only to spread this message to everybody. That is what we should say. Divine Life Society has been set up only for that. And Gurudev Swami Sivananda Maharaj, as a prelude to this, or as you see, incidental and also part of his own program, that he wanted that we should have peace throughout the world. At that time, of course, this First World War was over between 1914 to 1919, and thereafter we were in the throes of that Second World War also, was there, that was in the offing. In 1936, our Swami, this Divine Life Society was released. So Gurudev was also keen that we should have, because in order to have real happiness, we must have peace among all the people of the world. All humanity, all brothers and sisters, we must live together happily. That is the basic first requirement for anything worthwhile or proceeding in the spiritual path. That is a basic sine qua non, you see. With that only anything else is possible. So Gurudev wanted that one of his other missions is that we must also have how to spread peace in the entire world. And whatever best is possible, we should try to do so that people can live peacefully, happily. And then they will also be able to do something for their own spiritual practices, spiritual growth, and ultimately reaching, having the spiritual attainment of reaching the spiritual, this final destination. How to have God realization. Gurudev said that goal of life is God realization. Because it is only by having God realization that we can have liberation or moksha. It is only by God realization that our cycle of births and deaths that comes to an end. Because we are all human beings. We have been born one day and we cannot live here permanently. This is not our permanent abode. We should not think that we have come, so this is our place and I will stay here for all time to come. That doesn't happen. One day we have to leave also. Any being which has been born has to die one day. That is what in Bhagavad Gita Lord Krishna says. Jatasya hi dhruvo mrityur. Dhruvam janma mrityasya. This is a sloka there. So any person who is born has to die one day. That is certain, definite. A person who has died has to be reborn. He has to come back to this world again. So, like that, birth, then death, then again rebirth, and again death. Like that only it continues. The cycle of births and deaths, it continues, to which all of us are subject. This will come to an end only when we have God realization, which will also give us liberation. Liberation is possible only when we have God realization. And this world in which we are, it is not a bed of roses. It is not that everything is very nice, you eat, drink and be merry and like that you go on. That is not here. And in fact, it is just the opposite. There is no particular permanent happiness here at all. In fact, there is no happiness here. Whatever the type of happiness with which we are familiar, that is only for a it is only sense satisfaction. That is all temporary. So this is not real happiness. There is no happiness in the world, Gurudev Swami Sivananda declared very boldly. And in the Bhagavad Gita also Lord Krishna has said, this is actually, this world is anityam asukham. This is impermanent and it is also devoid of happiness. Dukkhalayam asashvatam. This is an abode of sorrow. And asashvatam. Asashvatam. And it is actually, this is also asashvatam. This is also, nothing to worry about it. And he says, Lord Krishna says, dukkhalayam asashvatam. The world in which we live, which we have taken as a source of happiness, is actually just the opposite of it. It is an abode of sorrow, dukkhalayam, and it is asashvatam, impermanent, temporary, for a short period only. So we are all only travelers here, remaining for a short period, we have to go from it. And the cycle of births and deaths is continuing. And since we have so much of suffering here in this world, in one birth itself, what will happen if we keep on repeating with the birth after birth we come here? We have the same experience. There is no end to our sorrow and suffering. We will be continuing. It is only when we have liberation that this will come to an end. We will be free from it for all time to come. That is why God realization only can this give us this thing. And Gurudev said that therefore the goal of life is God realization. This message actually Gurudev wanted to spread to the entire world. This is real spiritual knowledge. And what should we do in order to have God realization? What spiritual practices we must undertake so that we are able to reach our destination? That is a part of the spiritual knowledge also. To spread this knowledge was the mission of Gurudev Swami Sivananda Maharaj. And as we said, Gurudev also wanted that we should all live happily. All the teachings of Gurudev Swami Sivananda Maharaj, they are only to see that how all can live happily together. He had said, serve all, love all, see God in all, and then all the entire, the same self or the same God is actually dwelling inside everybody. In our universal prayer also, there is one line there, you know, that is, thou art the indweller of all beings. The same Lord, same God actually is dwelling inside each one of us. So, there is a common unity of all of us. We are all one, literally and spiritually also, we are one. The same self or the Atma is inside all of us. That is the teaching of our scriptures, of the Veda, of the Upanishads, and that is what we must understand. If everybody, inside everybody there is God, and the divine spark is there inside all of us, then we are all brothers and sisters, we are all together, we are all one only. There is essential unity of the entire humanity. So we must have this sense of unity. We must live together happily, peacefully like this. So the Gurudev was also the message of peace. How we can have peace everywhere, wherever we have. So that is why when we have this prayer also, you say, Sarvesham Swasti Bhavatu. Then we say, Sarvesham Shantir Bhavatu. Sarvesham Purnam Bhavatu. Sarvesham Mangalam Bhavatu. That is what. This is our prayer. This is our wish. And what is Sarvesham Swasti? May all remain happy. May there be welfare to all. That is Sarvesham Swasti Bhavatu. Sarvesham Shantir Bhavatu. May all have peace. And then he says that Sarvesham Mangalam Bhavatu. May there be welfare for all. And nobody should have any suffering. Ma Kaschit Dukha Bhag Bhavet. Nobody should have any sort of pain, suffering or sorrow. That is what is it. That is our objective. That is the mission of Gurudev Swami Sivananda Maharaj. So Gurudev Swami Sivananda Maharaj also wanted that along with the spiritual knowledge, how there will be peace among all of us. So this is the mission of Gurudev Swami Sivananda Maharaj. And Swami Chidananda Maharaj, whose now birth centenary we are celebrating, being one of the foremost disciples of Gurudev Swami Sivananda Maharaj, and he also was the president of the Divine Life Society after Swami Sivananda Maharaj, since 1963 up to 2008, when he attained Mahasamadhi, he had finally he passed away from there. And up to that point, he was the president of the Divine Life Society. And Swami Chidananda Maharaj's only objective was to spread the message of Gurudev Swami Sivananda Maharaj. Whatever Gurudev taught, Swami Chidananda Maharaj, he wanted to make it wider. And how to reach as many people as possible, that was his basic quest. And in his own very simple and very lucid style also, he tried to explain, made exposition of all these things in a very further elaborated, more effective way. Like that, Swami Chidananda Maharaj, that was he took up upon himself. Now the question is, what is his birth centenary now we are celebrating? And this centenary year. Now, what is his legacy, Swami Chidananda Maharaj? Swami Chidananda Maharaj, normally what is it, he did not set up any ashram. Gurudev Swami Sivananda Maharaj has started the Divine Life Society. And the Sivananda Ashram also grew around him. He did not want to set up any ashram, Swami Sivananda Maharaj also. But automatically it came up when people all gathered together and around him, and naturally something had to be done for the stay and all that, so Sivananda Ashram also started. But Swami Chidananda Maharaj did not start any ashram of his own. So that was not his legacy. As a legacy, he did not leave any ashram for us. He also did not set up any institution. And he also did not start any organization also. He said that Swami Sivananda Maharaj, Gurudev's ashram, organization, Divine Life Society is sufficient for us. Our idea should be to carry on the work of the Divine Life Society, which was so dear to Gurudev Swami Sivananda Maharaj, more effectively and more widely. How best we can do that, he took up as the mission for himself. That was his, and he So he did not start any separate organization, that is what we should do. He didn't have that type of legacy. His legacy was how to spread the message of Gurudev Swami Sivananda Maharaj, and he all gave all talks and all these even discourses at different places. And he also this through videos and there what a DVD, CD, etc. I am not familiar with all these words and etc. So these things actually, whatever talks he has given, since almost you see, his when he was in the ashram during Gurudev's time, he used to give some lectures. In the academy also, Yoga Vedanta Forest Academy of the ashram, which was started by Gurudev Swami Sivananda Maharaj. At that time also he used to give lectures as a professor of Raja Yoga. Whatever lectures he has given at that time, that has come in the name of, I think, Yoga. There is one very good volume in that. And afterwards also, in 1959, he went to West. And that also for about 2 years or something, he went many places. He gave very beautiful lectures and instructions and discourses he had given. So, and thereafter, as president also, he continued that particular work. And then we have all his lectures, all the discourses that he has given, all the talks, and they are available to us in the form of books, in the form of these cassettes, CDs, DVDs, and whatever you have there. They are his legacy for us. They are the most important thing. More than any building or anything physical, he has given us the spiritual knowledge. That is the highest legacy for all of us. Swami Chidananda Maharaj, this is my understanding. I don't know whether I am right, but this is what my view is, that Swami Chidananda Maharaj did not have any separate organization, didn't start any ashram. Many people, in fact, he did not want to have his own even samadhi also. Any samadhi mandir also he didn't want to have. He didn't want that his body also should remain in this on the airplane. It should not, it will go to Ganga. That's what it is, that was his last instruction. And he said, for us, Gurudev is everything. We should do everything for Gurudev. If you do for Gurudev, we are also served by that. We are also benefited by like that. So his legacies, all his discourses, all his teachings, beautiful teachings and very effective, very simple and very instructive and very nicely Swamiji Maharaj has explained many things. All the essence of all the scriptures, etc., they are contained in Swami Chidananda Maharaj. All his talks and all his lectures are very beautifully, very easily understandable and also very effective. How they are helpful for day-to-day or practical life. That is all. So that is his legacy. So Swami Chidananda Maharaj, he spread the message of Gurudev Swami Sivananda, the spiritual message, that is one thing. The other one also for spreading the message of peace, Swami Chidananda Maharaj has done a lot. That is also one of the greatest legacies of Swami Chidananda Maharaj to all of us, to the posterity. So Swami Chidananda Maharaj said that he was a very great admirer of Saint Francis of Assisi. And many people, in fact, because he has been talking of Swami, this Saint Francis of Assisi, whenever he used to go, mostly, particularly in the West, he used to always talk mostly about Saint Francis of Assisi. And in India also, during his talks, some or other it will come there. So there is a very famous prayer of Swami, Saint Francis of Assisi, that Lord, make me an instrument of thy peace. If you are aware of that, that is there, etc. And wherever Swamiji used to have an occasion, he will refer to this and then talk about Saint Francis and also say that how is it. And he will repeat the whole prayer. Saint Francis, Lord, make me an instrument of thy peace. Where there is discord, union, all those things, that is all there. So when that particular thing is there, so being an instrument of peace and also to give the idea of peace, spread it, and also to give the clue also how to have this peace for ourselves, peace in the world, peace in the surroundings, peace in the family, peace in everywhere, you see, wherever we are, how we can spread the message of peace. That was the legacy of Swami Chidananda Maharaj. He stressed upon this for quite some time. And very he gave a lot of emphasis on this also. So this is how Swami Chidananda Maharaj's legacy has come to us. And he actually supplemented and then fulfilled the mission of Gurudev Swami Sivananda Maharaj. Now, this peace that we are talking of, that is very necessary for all of us. Why peace is necessary? You are talking of that Bhagavad Gita. In the Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna says, without peace you can't have happiness. Ashantasya kutaha sukham. Like that it is there in the Bhagavad Gita. If you do not have peace, how can you have happiness? Because the basic requirement for happiness is our mind must be at peace. That is the first starting point. Then only you will try to build up happiness on that. If our mind is disturbed, how can you have peace of mind? And then how can you have happiness? No happiness is possible without peace. That we have to understand. That is the basic one. So, Swami Sivananda Maharaj said that how to have peace of mind. And Swami Chidananda Maharaj also, he elaborated on that very nicely. And so, now this, when we have this, for where to find peace of mind, where is the peace to be found? That is the question we have to answer here. Where is the peace to be found? You cannot go to the market and then go to a shop there at the mall and say, give me peace. I will give you how many dollars? Whatever dollars you want, I will give you, give me peace. Can we buy peace in the any shop, anywhere, in the market? It is not possible. Is peace available anywhere outside, anywhere in a physical condition? That also is not, oh yes, here it is peace, let me take it from here. You can go to the garden and find there some flowers are there, you will pluck a flower and bring it. Or you have some tree where there is some good mangoes and fruits are there, you take a mango from there, yes, I have taken it. Peace is not like that. It is not something tangible, something which is concrete, which is available outside. You just take it and then, yes, then you are happy with this. That is not possible. So where is peace to be found? And the peace in the world, peace in inside us, peace in the individual, these two are linked up things. Because we are inside the world. If there is peace in the world, then we will have peace. That is quite logical. And we are also inside the world. If we have peace, then we can have peace outside. Because we only, all of us, go to make the world. So if we are at peace, we have peace, and all of us have peace, then automatically there is peace in the world. So that is how these two are interlinked. Our own individual peace and peace in the world, these two are, they are, you see, interconnected. One depends on the other. Because the individuals only go to make the society. We only make the world. So if we are at peace, automatically there is peace in the world. But at the moment what we see in the world, we don't have peace. There is so much of conflict. There is so much of war, and then people are actually at loggerheads. They see there is so much of fight, there is so much of war, there is so much of strife, and people don't have peace, happiness is not there. There is no sense of security also, so much of it. Particularly nowadays if we see this terrorist activities, this is an extreme thing. Even before that also we did not have sufficient peace in the world. After this, even before the terrorists started their active work, now we see, which we are now facing, even then also we did not have peace. We are not having peace in the world. That is why we had two global wars. And even there was this fear that the third world war can break up at any time. You see this, the 50s, 60s and 70s of the 20th century, even 80s also. It was all there. Fortunately, now some good sense has prevailed on mankind. Now at least that such war in a mass scale is not actually in the... it is not looming at large with us. That is why we are at a little peace now. So this peace, why it is coming? That is because peace is dependent on us, on the individual. And real peace is not outside. Our real peace is actually inside us. If we are at peace, if you know how to be at peace, wherever we are there, we can be at peace. Let there be anything in the world. But if we know how to get peace for ourselves, within ourselves, then we can be at peace everywhere, wherever we go. The outside world will not affect us. That is actually, so peace is actually internal. Peace is personal. Peace is depending on the individual himself. This is what we must understand. And if this is there, even if outwardly, in outside world, we don't have so much of peace, even then we will be able to manage, we will not be so much disturbed. But if we do not have peace within us, even if outside there is so much of quiet and then peace, we will not be benefited by that. This is what we should understand. So, our peace is actually inside us. Peace is not outside. This we must remember. In the Bhagavad Gita, actually, Lord Krishna has given very good ideas, very nice things, the instructions he has given. How to have peace of mind? What is the way to have peace? And in the second chapter, from this 60 onwards, some verses are there, they specifically deal with those things. So Lord Krishna says, now, how you can have peace? One sloka he says, Raja Raga Yukta Yuktaistu, Raga Dvesa Vijuktaistu, Vishayan
Indriyascharan, Atma Vasya Vidhir Atma,
Atma Vasya Vidhir Atma, Prasantasya Adhigakshati. Here the meaning is, Raga Dvesa. Raga means is likes and dislikes. A person who have this Raga and Dvesa, actually these things disturb our mind. Raga and Dvesa, likes and dislikes, strong likes and strong dislikes, attraction and aversion. And then you see this, these things which are there, and attachment and malice. These are all these words, the meaning of this Raga and also these Dvesa. These two actually are very important things. These two come in many places, in many scriptures also. They are the very, very basic things. If you know in this Patanjali Yoga Sutra also, he says there are five klishta vrittis, the mental modifications which are painful, which they create problem for us. So, avidya, asmita, raga, dvesha, abhinivesha, like that. There also this raga, dvesha, it comes there. Raga and dvesha. These two actually, they disturb us. They are the causes of our mental suffering. And they only take a peace. That's why Lord Krishna here says, Raga Dvesa Vijuktaistu. If you are free, I mean our this senses actually, sense organs should not be affected or guided by our this Raga and Dvesa, these two words. They are very key to us for having peace. So if one is free, when our sense organs are free from Raga and Dvesa, Raga Dvesa, strong likes and dislikes, attraction and aversion, and then attachment, and also you see malice. These are all the meaning of this Raga Dvesa. If our senses are not guided by these two factors, these two you see mental propensities, Raga Dvesa Vijuktaistu, Vishayan Indriyascharam, Atma Vasya Vidheyatma, Prasadam Adhigachati. How we can have peace of mind? He says, that because we are living in a world, for carrying on with our day-to-day activities, even for sustaining our own life, we have to engage in the world. Our sense organs will have to function. You cannot just put a close to everything, a stop to everything, and then I will not do anything. This is not possible in the world. We have to live. For living, we have to actually operate through our senses. Our sense organs will have to be active. Mind also has to be exercised, mind also has to be utilized for the purpose of doing all our work, anything that is required in our world. Sense organs and mind, these two things are very important, necessary for us. So we operate through our sense organs. So Lord Krishna says, when we work in the world through these senses, at that time, if we want to have peace of mind, we have to see that, you see, our sense organs should not be guided by these two principles, this Raga and also Dvesha. Attachment, aversion, all these things like this. So if we can make our mind free from this, that means attraction, you see, we have got attachment something, we get some pleasure for something, we are attached to it. If we are attached to that, we do something, even wrong things also do when we have some attachment to something. So this attachment actually is created because of our problem. And because of attachment also, this the opposite negative quality comes, this aversion. We hate some people. We do not like certain circumstances. So we develop desha, or this hatred towards that itself, malice, and then aversion, and then dislike it is there. So these two actually are very strong forces which create a problem. They disturb our mind. And also we go towards them for having, you see, doing something wrong. So then if we want to have peace of mind, Lord Krishna says, our sense organs must be free from this attachment and aversion, attraction and aversion. Then, even if we carry on with all our duties in the world, we work through our sense organs. Our sense organs are active. They are engaged in something. There is no problem. And then he says, Atma Vashye, we must control our sense organs, controlled by ourselves. You see, we must exercise control over the sense organs. Vidhyatma. Then we must be self-controlled also. Self-control means our mind should be fully controlled. Sense organs also should be controlled. These two things, they actually make us self-controlled. In these two self things, so then he says, what is self-control? That means we utilize our mind. We employ all our this sense organs. But what is good? What is right? What is proper? Not allow them to go into the wrong directions. Not to do something excessive. Not to do something which is harmful for others or harmful to ourselves. So like this. So if our sense organs and also the mind are fully under control, if we have self-control, that is Vidhyatma. If with these qualifications, with these attributes, if we carry on with our world, then even if we are inside the world, we do all our activities, yet we will be having peace. This is what is the one requirement, one condition, how we can have peace of mind. He says, such a person, he prasadam adhigacchati. Prasada is peace, mental peace. One person, a person who is operating through his sense organs, yet he keeps them under control, utilizes them properly, and carries on with all his normal, legitimate and proper activities, then he will not have any problem. But we have to be free from raga and desha, which are the two mental afflictions. Those two must be at a distance. We must keep away from them. Then that is one. Then he says, if you do that, then what will be the benefit from that? Then he says, prasade sarva dukkhanam hani rasyopajayate. Prasanna chetaso hyasu buddhir paryavasthate. He says, what is the benefit, what is the gain from this peace of mind? He says, prasade sarva dukkhanam hani rasyopajayate. When we have peace of mind, all our sorrow, suffering, mental difficulty, everything actually, they are destroyed. They don't remain in our mind any longer. Our mind is at rest, mind is at peaceful, then he gets happiness. Prasade sarva dukkhanam hani rasyopajayate. Prasanna chetasa, when a person is having a cheerful mind, when his mind is having peace, when it is tranquil, at that time, buddhir parjavasya, then our mind, our brain, or our, you see, intellect becomes steady. Steady means we have proper understanding. So we have got proper discrimination at that time. And then our mind also has proper understanding, intellect has got proper understanding. So if we have right discrimination, then we don't make any mistake. We will not do anything wrong. So then our mind becomes steady. Our intellect becomes steady. Our understanding also becomes perfect. So that is the gain when we have the peace of mind. If we have this peace of mind, so we must, how logically, step by step, Lord Krishna says, how we will have this peace of mind and what is the benefit of that, that we should understand this. And then, when we have this, but how can you have peace of mind, how can you have happiness? In another way also, Lord Krishna, he analyzes it. He says, nasti buddhi rajuktasya nacha yuktasya bhavana nacha bhavate shanti asantasya kutah sukham. We are keen about peace, we want to have peace of mind. How will you have this? You must understand what is the sequence, how we can have peace of mind. He says, nasti buddhi rajuktasya we cannot have proper understanding or discrimination of the mind if our mind is not under control. Ayuktasya, if it is not properly controlled. If we are not established in principles of yoga, we can interpret it anyway. So if our mind is not controlled, then your mind, you cannot have this. You cannot have right understanding. Nasti buddhi rajuktasya. Nacha yuktasya bhavana. If our mind is not under control, if it is not established in the principles of yoga, if you do not have self-control, you cannot also have a contemplative mind. You cannot have meditation. Contemplation will not be possible. Nacha yuktasya bhavana. One who is not, you see, established or controlled by yoga or has self-control, he is not harmonized, his mind cannot be steady, therefore he cannot do any contemplation or meditation. What is the harm if you don't have meditation? Why we should do meditation? Then he says that, Nacha bhavata shanti. If you want to have peace of mind, you must have meditation. If you do not have meditation, a person who does not have meditation, he cannot have peace of mind. So, for having peace of mind, regular contemplation, meditation, keeping the mind steady is very necessary. That is all. So, nocha bhavata shanti. A person who does not control his mind, who does not regularly practice meditation or contemplation, he cannot have peace of mind. That is not possible. And if you do not have peace of mind, how will you have happiness? Asantasya kutasuka. He asked the question to Arjuna. A person doesn't have this peace of mind, how will he have happiness? So for having happiness, we have to have peace of mind. For having peace of mind, we must also have regular meditation. Practice meditation. Because by meditation only, our mind becomes calm. Raga, dvesha, all this malice and then hatred, and also say, aversion, likes, dislikes, all the elements which disturb our mind, they are all eliminated through this meditation by exercising self-control. So that is the way to peace. This also Lord Krishna says in this. That is also we must understand. He also further goes and says that, you see, how will you have, who can have peace of mind? He also gives a very good analogy. He says that just as in the, we see this ocean is there. In the ocean, you see, it is full from all sides. In everywhere, all around it is full. Even if the rivers come there, they throw their water into the ocean. The ocean is not disturbed. It is always at peace. As at peace as it was before. Even if the water of the rivers, even like from Amazon, even the water comes, it doesn't disturb the ocean. It is always just peaceful. And it is apuryamanam achara pratishtam. It is always full. And secondly, it says that it is not at all disturbed by so much of water coming from the rivers into the ocean. All the waters it comes, it absorbs to itself, the ocean. These waters of the ocean, the rivers do not create any, cannot create any disturbance in it. Of course, it is in the surface, in the coast only a little shaking will be there. Thereafter, they get merged in that. So, the ocean is always at peace, always undisturbed. And it is always full like that. He gives an, similarly, if a person whose mind is like this, he only can have peace of mind. Then he says that just as in the, when we have this, the ocean is there which is not disturbed by so much of water coming from so many rivers, and yet it remains calm, peaceful and also undisturbed. Similarly, the desires which come to us, desires always keep on coming to us, etc. If a person is able to absorb all the desires that come to his mind, he absorbs into himself. And he does not allow the desires to create any problem, any ripple in his mind. And he absorbs to himself, and then ultimately they subside there. They end there, they are destroyed there, etc. If such a person will be able to do all the desires of the mind, because it is the desires only which disturb our mind. They take away our peace. So if we are able, a person who is able to absorb all the desires to himself, into himself, does not allow to have any reaction from inside. It does not act upon the desires or in pursuance of the desires and absorbs all the desires to himself. He only can have peace of mind. That means desires make no effect on him, no, you see, impact on him. He is always undisturbed, peaceful and calm. He is not affected or disturbed by the desires. If a person can be like that, then only one can have peace of mind. The sloka which he says, that is, Apuryamanam Achala Pratishtam Samudramapa Pravishanti Yadvat Tadvat Kama Yam Pravishanti Sarve Sa Shanti Mapnoti Natu Kama Kami. He says, just as we explained about this ocean, etc. If Tadvat Kama Yam Pravishanti Sarve, like that, as in the case of the ocean, if all the desires which come to a person, if he is able to absorb into himself, Tadvat Kama Yam Pravishanti Sarve, all these desires actually enter into him. And it is only one-way traffic. He brings in the desires, supposing they arise, he takes into himself, absorbs within himself, does not act on that, does not allow them to create any disturbance in his mind, and so they subside there and they are destroyed, they are actually, they are assimilated for all time to come. Yes, sata ida. Tadvat kama ajam pravishanti sarve. Sa shanti mapnoti. He alone can get happiness. He only attains happiness. Natu kama kami. Not the person who always entertains desires and who also acts upon that. And who also is disturbed by that, carried away by all these desires, etc. If you go on, you see, Natu kama kami, these two words are there. Kami is a person who has desires. And kama here, we have to take either desires or either the objects of pleasure in the world. That is the meaning of this kama. A person who has desires for all the objects of the world, sense pleasures, he cannot have peace of mind. Natu kama kami. This is a categorical statement. Clearly Lord Krishna says that you can't have just this peace if you are having these desires. The only way is to see that we control our desires. That is the way to peace. Because it is only the desires which take our peace. If we assimilate all the desires, don't act upon that, don't have any reaction to that, then we are at peace. This is what we must understand. And finally he says that why did the person who will really get peaceful, how he will have peace of mind? And the last sloka which is there, he says, Vihaya kaman yasarvan pumang charati nispruha nirmamo nirahankara sashanti madhigacchati. He says, a person who roams about in the world, Vihaya kaman sarvan, one who gives up all his desires. Remember, if you want to have peace of mind, this is the only way. So, one, we must give up all desires. He only can have the final peace of mind. The lasting peace which we are having. When we have that liberation, or liberation, that type of peace, for that it is necessary. He says, when a person, any person, who has been able to give up all his desires, Vihaya Kaman Sarvan, he says, all the desires, and the Kuman, the person, or the human being, or the man, or the same person, any human being. And Vihaya Kamanja Sarvan Pumangs Charati Nispruha. He moves about in the world. That means he carries on with all his activities in the world. And Nispruha, without having any desire, any hankering, or any craving. That is Nispruha itself. A person who is free from all craving, all desires, all hankering for sense objects. If a person can move like this, etc., this is one criterion, one requirement for having peace of mind. And he also says that nirmamo, nirahankara, two more, you see, terms Lord Krishna uses here. We must be free from the sense of attachment, sense of mindness, nirmamo. Because it is this attachment only disturbs our mind. And it loses our sense of discrimination, only attachment. Because I think it is mine. this is me, this is mine, that is mine, this is mine, like this. Whether it is a family, or it is a house, or it is your car, or it is anything else, or everything we have got, this is mine, this is mine, this is mine. This is called mamata, or sense of mindness. If you want to have peace of mind, if you want to have happiness, we must give up this thing. So, a person who is free from this sense of mindness, sense of attachment to anything, it is doesn't mean that you say, then if you don't have food, if food is not mine, then how I will eat? We should not take it to that extent. The point is, whatever is necessary, don't have attachment to anything in this. We live in the world. Make use of all the things legitimately, whatever is possible, yet without having the sense of attachment. If it is not there, supposing for some reason, because of certain reasons or some under certain circumstances, we lose something, we should not be affected by that. We should not be upset by that. But if we have attachment, oh, immediately we say, the heavens have fallen now. And then you say, all our peace is gone, oh, it is gone, gone, like that. We should, I will have peace of mind. So like that, do not have any sense of attachment. Live in the world. Have all the things which are necessary, which is legitimate, proper. And yet, without the sense of attachment, without the sense of mindness, if it's a mental state, it is not physically. Physically you may be near a particular thing, yet it is not mine. I have no sense of mindness so far as this thing is concerned. If we have that, so nirmoho, one who is free from the sense of mindness. And nirankara. Nirankara means a person who is free from egoism. We all feel that, you say, I am a great person. Our ego is working like this. I am a great person. I have done that. I have that done. And all these things. These are all manifestations of this ego. And this ego only, you see, it also, because of the ego, all our problems start. When you have this ego, because of that, you see, we have this lust, anger, greed, jealousy, hatred, all those things, they come because of our ego only. Because when we have this ego, ahankar, or this is it. Then I consider myself a separate individual. I consider that this body is mine, I am this body. I also think that this body is my instrument for enjoyment in this life, in the world, etc. So like this, all these things, one after another, they come to us. So for the sake of the body, for the sake of myself, or for my own, you see, mind, mentally thinking, for ego, I am prepared to do anything. I can go to any extent, do anything like this. So, lust, anger, greed, jealousy, hatred, they all, you see, they are the offshoots of our egoism. They only create all our problems. We do all wrong things because of this ego. It is the ego only which binds us to this world. It is only because of the ego that, you see, we have this, all, you see, the things which are very improper for us, which are a source of trouble, we go for that only because of the ego. So, this we must remember. He says, if you want to have peace of mind, he says, you should be nirahankara, free from egoism. That means lust, anger, greed, jealousy, hatred, then pride, infatuation, all those things. In Sanskrit we call it kama, krodha, loha, moha, mada, matsarya. These are all there. And then this Patanjali Maharshi also says in that, among this is asmita, that is also the same egoism. So this egoism is the cause of all our trouble. If we can be free from egoism, then we will have peace of mind. So that is why Lord Krishna says, Vihaya kamanja sarvan pumans charati nishtriha nirmamo nirahankana sa shantim adhigacchati. He only can get peace. He attains peace, a person who is free from all desires, who have no hankering for anything. He moves about freely. He is free from the sense of mindness. He is free from the sense of egoism. And he can attain peace. And then Lord Krishna says, not only he does peace, as attains peace, this is actually the state of liberation. This is the state of highest Brahmic realization. Esa Brahmi sthiti partha. This is the Brahmi state. What we have heard, what Swami Sivananda Maharaj has reached that particular stage where he attained liberation and then also he was established in the Jivan Mukti state, or attainment of Brahmic realization, the realization of the absolute, the highest reality, which always there is. If we have this type of peace of mind, then we can attain to that state. This will take us, that this alone is that particular state like this. So now as spiritual seekers, for now we must now understand how we can have peace of mind. If we have peace of mind, we can have also this, the peace in the world also will come. We can have happiness only if we have peace of mind. So what we must have for this peace of mind, etc. Why we have peace of mind, we can understand now. Because essentially, we have to be free from our egoism. Ego means identification with our mind, intellect, and also ego. Mind has actually four aspects: mano, buddhi, ahankara, and chitta. These are the four aspects of our mind. There it comes, the ego is there, mind is also there, intellect is also there. So this is what it is there, they are not our real self, that is not our real nature. Our real nature, we are really the self or the atma which is inside all of us. That is our real nature. And the nature of this atma or the self which is there inside, that is also the same God also. So his nature is peace. Ayam atma shanta. Shanto ayam atma. Like that it is put in this Upanishads. So this peace, the self, my real I, actually is the atma or the self, and that is, its nature is peace. Because we identify ourselves with our mind, with our ego, with our intellect, with our body, we consider that this is what we are, and then we do not know what is this peace we have lost. So if we are aware of that particular thing, that I am really that particular atma or the self, whose nature is peace, who is peace itself. God and Atma, you see, they are not two different things. Because same God, you see, from one point of view, we think that He is the God creator and all that, like this. The same God who dwells inside all of us, He is our Atma, or the Self. God and Atma are the same. And they are also, their nature is peace of mind. So if we identify ourselves with that, that I am that Atma, not this ego, not this mind, not this intellect, then we should be always, we can have peace of mind. This is what we should understand. And Swami also says that, you see, this, the same Atma also dwells in all creatures, everywhere, inside all human beings and everything. Since the same Atma is there, there is essential unity of the entire humanity. There is essential unity of all creatures. We are all one family, we are all one in fact. Only for a temporary period we are separate individuals, but otherwise we are only one. If this feeling is there, then we will be able to see our own self only in everybody, and the entire humanity is also like that. Then we can have peace of mind. If we have peace of mind, with that only we can also try to spread this message of peace to everybody, all around us, and that will actually also give us peace of mind. And that will be a step towards world peace. How we can have peace of the mind, peace of the, in the world? First we must have peace in the family itself. Within the family we must think that it's the same God is dwelling in all family members. We are all one. Although we are having different individuals, we are different, having different bodies, that is only temporary for a period. Otherwise we are all essentially one. If that feeling of oneness, feeling of the same self being everywhere, if that is actually the guiding factor for all our activities in the world, then that will actually be the harbinger of peace. That will be the step towards peace. So we, in the family, we can have peace of mind. In your office place also, if we have that attitude, everywhere the same God is there, same Atma is there, so we will have peace of mind. In your, this you see, Sivananda Centre which you are having here also the same God is only there. In all the yoga practitioners, the same God is there. Same Atma is there. Everywhere if we can see the same God everywhere, same Atma everywhere, then we can have peace of mind. That will be there. And we should also try to spread this message of this same principle, same thing being inside all. That will be actually a step towards that. And as spiritual seekers and yoga practitioners, we must also practice this yama, the principles of Yama, which are there in the Patanjali Yoga Sutra, eight-limbed yoga, first is Ahimsa, Satyam, Brahmacharya, Aparigraha, and then Asteya, these five principles. They are actually the foundation for peace. We must try to follow these principles in our life. Ahimsa is non-injury, not try to harm anybody, not to be a source of pain or suffering to anybody. That we should try to follow, observe in our day-to-day conduct. And similarly, they speak on the truth. If we do not speak the truth, means you see we are trying to cheat somebody. In order to cheat only, we speak, resort to falsehood or lie. So that is against this principle of unity. So if we have tried to be truthful also, Ahimsa, then truthfulness, and also purity in our life, purity of conduct, and Brahmacharya, observing the celibacy and all that, the conservation of all our energy, and non-stealing, Asteya, and also Aparigraha, not having too much opposition. So these principles of Yama which are there, if we follow those principles, etc., then that will also help us to have our own peace of mind. Because our peace of mind is disturbed because of these six enemies of peace. We just discussed those things. Though, as you call, they call it six enemies. Sadritu in Sanskrit is there. Kama, Krodha, Lobha, Moha, Madha, Matsarya. So, lust, anger, greed, jealousy, hatred, and also this the pride, infatuation. So, these are actually disturbing our peace. Our peace is being taken away or stolen by these enemies. We must understand. So, to have our inner peace within ourselves, we must try to be free from all these negative elements, negative thoughts which are there, negative way of acting. Then we will be able to have peace of mind. We must also try to have, as Gurudev has said, serve all, love all, be kind, be compassionate. And see the same God in all. Well, if our nature, if have love all, have love for everybody. And we should try to be kind, be compassionate also, have compassion for others. And if somebody has done some mistake, forget about it also. Forgive him, forget and forgive what Gurudev has said. So these are the bare injury, bare insult, bare injury. All these things we should try to practice. If you try to, then we can have peace of mind. Otherwise, if there is some situation, somebody does something, if we start acting, we have anger, or we have got, you see, or greed, or jealousy, then we can't have peace of mind. And we must practice all the virtues also. And then, free from this all negative elements, then we'll be able to have peace of mind itself. Now, we should also not be guided by selfishness. We should be selfless. Because it is our selfishness only for which we do all sorts of wrong things. And a person who is very selfish, he can go to any extent, you see, to thrive at the cost of others. He can do harm to others. He can also, you see, do anything without bothering about the interest of others, the feelings of others. So that is because of selfishness. So if you want to have peace of mind, we must be free from the selfishness also. Try to be selfless as much as possible. And doing selfless service to others, doing good to others, that is also very necessary. So these are some of the very important points which we must always, we should have, as Gurudev has said, be good, do good, try to be good always. Try to practice goodness and try to have love for others. And also try to do only good things for us, try to help others, be of help to others as much as possible. These are the ways because by which we develop positive virtues and all good qualities in our mind becomes peace. If we act contrary to this, then our mind actually is disturbed, negative thoughts come to us, our way of life is actually opposite to all this the positive thinking. Then that will disturb our peace. That is why we must understand this. So, and in Patanjali Maharshi also he says, in how to conduct ourselves also in the society, how we can go about, in when we live in the world, how we can have peace of mind. He says there are four types of conduct, or four types of relations we should try to observe in our day-to-day life. Because when we have in the world, when we move among the people, we have four categories of people. One is some people who are our equals, our owners. for our equals, we must have the attitude of friendliness. Just be friendly to everybody, not have this negative quality of just having any dislike or anything, but we should have cultivate friendliness. And his Maitri, Karuna, Mudita and Upeksha. These four principles have to be observed by us when we are moving in the world, if our peace has to remain intact. This first thing is Maitri, we must try to observe so far as our equals are concerned. Don't be jealous of them. And don't also try to do anything which is harmful to them. Or don't be disturbed by them in it. Be very friendly with them. Friendliness is required. And for our superiors, those who are higher than us in somewhere or the other, in a more advantageous position. And don't be affected by that. Don't have any jealousy towards them. Don't also feel yourself very inferior. If he is superior, it is up to him. Why you should feel yourself inferior? Don't have any inferiority complex. And for that, then he says that for them, have this sense of, you see, contentment. Mudita. Be happy with whatever is there, let it be happy also. If this attitude, it is called mudita. Be happy with other than let him be happy in there. I am quite happy with me. For rather, I should know there are many people who are worse than me. I am much better than other people, etc. So why should I look upon upwards the person who is in a more advantageous position? Rather look downwards. So that we don't compare ourselves with that and lose our peace. So like this. For that, you see, mudita or contentment we must have. Being happy with whatever other people have got. If one person is very rich, it is his business. Why I should be affected by that? God has given him, let it be all right. I am happy with whatever I have got. That attitude also. So this is the second thing. So, mudita. And then third thing also, we must have karuna or compassion for all the people who are in a less advantageous position as compared to us. Those who are really a little inferior or who are not, we say, well off in the life. If they are in a position who are a little inferior to us, we should have an attitude of compassion towards them. And have mercy, compassion, and feel for them. And try to do whatever best is possible. If that is, instead of, you see, looking down upon them, or instead of trying to, you see, harass them also somewhere or the other, then you let them be happy. And we should be of help to them as much as possible. If that is the attitude we have, that is how we should deal with the people who are at a lower position, so far as we are concerned, in a less advantageous position. And third thing, there will be some people who are positive nuisance, who will create problem for us. They are, you see, very difficult people also. And for such people, it is better indifferent. Be indifferent. Don't be affected by them. Don't have too much of dealings with them. And not be also affected by what they are doing. Don't bother about them. Let them be happy there. Keep them at a safe distance. If you do that, then you see our peace will not be affected. So like this, generally when we are moving about in the society, in life, whether within the family or outside in your office or in your business place or in the society, we meet these category of four people, four categories of people only. You can't have any fifth category because all are included in this. Either somebody who will be above us, somebody who is below us, or somebody who is equal to us, or somebody who is a positive nuisance for us, who will create problem for us. It is their nature to create problem for others, for no reason of, we are not responsible for it. Even then, without any cause, they will try to create problem for us. They are actually demons, demons in human guard. They are demoniacal people only, they will say, without any problem, without any provocation, they will come to you and create problem for you. This is what they do also. So such people will be there. Our best thing for us will be avoid them as much as possible. Ignore them. Be indifferent to them. Udasina, that word is also there. So it is a upeksha. That means ignore them like that. If you have this type of dealings with these four categories of people, that also will give us peace. Our peace will not be disturbed. That is the way for our practical guidance. How to conduct ourselves in the society. So that, you see, we are not affected by the happenings inside the world or while moving among the people, yet we have peace of mind. But more than anything else, this we must always have this, what Lord Krishna had said, be free from desires. A person who does not have any desire, if one is able to take out all his desires from his mind, he only can have peace of mind. And not to kamakami, not the person who keeps on entertaining all his desires in his mind. He goes after thinking, one desire after another desire like that. He goes on thinking of desires only and how to fulfill them. How will you have peace of mind? You can't have that. If you want to have peace of mind, be free from all desires. Move out in this world. And just as a person who has realized the highest stage, Vihaya Kaman Sarvan, giving up all one's desires and being totally free from all cravings and all, you see, these anxieties from the mind, etc. This Prabhava, and a person who moves about freely and without any fear, without any worry, without any, you see, botheration, he is not bothered by anything. Because if you have some desire, then you will have some attachment. If you have some attachment, you will feel very much concerned about it, you will worry about it, then you will not have peace of mind. That is what he says. So a person who doesn't have any desire, he is happy under all circumstances. He is at peace in everything that happens. Even if anything happens, he is not bothered about it. Okay. It is God's will. Let it happen that way. How does it matter? I can adjust to that also. What Gurudev has told us also. Adapt, adjust, accommodate. Where insult, where injury. This is the highest sadhana. Swami Sivananda Maharaj has told us. This is what, if you want to have peace of mind, we should practice this thing. Adapt, adjust, accommodate. Bear insult, bear injury. That is the highest sadhana. That is the way to peace. Remembering all this, if we can try to make our mind free from all desires, not to have any desire at all, and carry on with anything that happens in this world, and being happy and contented under all circumstances, then nothing can affect us. Nothing will disturb our peace, and we will all be at peace, even if we are inside a very disturbed society, disturbed place. If the world is disturbed, let it be outside. That disturbance will be outside. It will not affect us. If a person has reached that stage, that should be our goal, to have peace of mind. So, inner peace is first. We can have peace of mind only, peace only inside ourselves. Peace is not outside. It is a state of our mind. How we have been able to train our mind, how we have been able to, you see, channelize, control our mind in such a manner that it is not disturbed by anything. Anything that happens outside, any desire comes also, that doesn't affect us, we are not disturbed. If you can reach that stage, and not important, not to have any attachment, not to have any mindness, not have any sense of mindness about anything. Read it all there, it is all God's in whatever we can put it. If we have that, being free from mindness, being free from egoism, and being free from all desires, then what else is left? Nothing else is left. Everything we have given up now. If you can give this much, then only we can have peace of mind. That is the way, that is the teaching of Lord Krishna, Bhagavad Gita. A person who has been able to give up all his desires, he becomes a sthita prajna. A person who is able to give up all his desires, then he is called a person who is sthita prajna, whose mind is always calm and steady. That is what is there, and that is our goal. As spiritual seekers, we should try to do this. The key to our success in sadhana, key to have peace, is to give up all desires. Try to be free from desires as much as possible, and not to be affected by anything in the world, and be contented under all circumstances. Anything that comes to us, it is okay for me. If this attitude we can have, then we will be free. Our mind will be free from all anxiety, sorrow and suffering. And there will be peace in our mind. And that will give us absolute happiness. And as Lord Krishna has said, if you can do this, practice these things, you will reach the highest stage of liberation also. Esa Brahmi Sthiti, that is the state of realization of Brahman, or the highest absolute, which is the goal of all. There only we can have ultimate peace, final peace and total peace, eternal peace, and then everlasting peace, bliss, everything will come when we are able to reach that state. Even while living also we can have that state. Being alive also we can reach that state. To be in that state we don't have to die first and then only we will live. It is not necessary. So that is what? That is the teaching of the Bhagavad Gita. very good. And may the blessings of Lord Krishna be upon all of us. Of blessings of Gurudev Swami Sivananda Maharaj, blessings of Swami Chidananda Maharaj, blessings of our most worshipful Swami Vishnudevananda Maharaj. May their blessings and of all sages and saints be upon all of us. And may all of us try to have absolute peace of mind. If we can succeed in that, I think we can reach the, our sadhana is complete. That only will make us some. And all the other yoga practices, etc., which you are doing, all this asana, pranayama, all that, they are very necessary. It is only to take us to that particular state. If we can have that view and then carry on, then God will bless us and Gurudev also will bless us. We will be able to have this peace of mind, which is our basic concern, which worries all of us. We are worried about peace, so our peace is gone. Like that. So we should not worry at all. Even about peace also, don't worry. If we can be free from everything, free from all worries, then we will have peace. That is the way to key to peace. Thank you very much. Our thanks to our this Sivananda Centre, what we call it?
International Yoga Vedanta
Centre. Yeah. Sivananda
Yoga Vedanta
Centre. Yes. So, to our revered Kamala Mataji and all the other colleagues and other persons who are there, our grateful thanks to all of you for having given us this opportunity of coming here, spending some time with you all. You are all very sincere and keen seekers on the path of yoga. It's very nice to see you all. So our many grateful thanks to all of you. Our thanks to our this Divine Life Society Australia also, who have organized this, arranged this particular program here. That is also very nice. Our thanks to our Jesse Mataji and all others of the Divine Life Society, and Vijayji and others who are all there, and our this Gurvanji, who has taken the trouble of bringing us here, and also our Radhakrishna Sarmaji also, and all the others who are very closely associated with this. And I am thankful to all of you. My grateful thanks to all of you. And once again, thanks to our Sivananda Yoga Vedanta Centre. And thanks to Kamala Mataji. And thanks to everybody. Thank you very much. All the best.
Thank you. Thank you.